Next one we'll see about the eddy current laws. You can hear me properly?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Next one is eddy current laws. Hysteresis loss we have seen. To reduce hysteresis loss, silicon steel is used. Okay, because area under the hysteresis loop is less. Next one is eddy current loss, which takes place again in core. This one not done last time, isn't it? Right? Up to this we have seen in previous lecture, right? Okay. Hysteresis loss, this is the formula for that. Here also KE is AD current constant, means AD current loss constant, you can say. BM is the same as that of previous one, maximum flux density, flux per unit area, it's square, frequency square, and T here stands for thickness, not the time. Okay, it's a thickness of each plate, it's square. Okay, so you what's the unit for this? Watt per unit volume. It is not watt, it's a watt per unit volume. Earlier one, whatever the formula for hysteresis loss, it was in watt. So here it is a watt per unit volume. So this is the formula. Now here you can say, you can see here, once you manufacture the core, T is constant, supply frequency is constant, and K is constant. Okay. And in the previous one also, hysteresis loss, this one is constant, frequency is constant, V for volume of core, this one is also constant, and flux density, that is the flux per unit area. Once transformer get manufactured, its cross-sectional area of core also remains constant. Okay, it means it will be constant once you design the transformer, once it get manufactured. So area of core also remains constant, and we'll see soon that transformer, it's a constant flux machine. Flux in the core always remains constant. So flux in the core always remains constant, area is constant, that's why flux density also will be constant. Means if you observe the formula of hysteresis loss, all the parameters are constant. If you observe the all the parameters of eddy current loss, then this one also constant. Okay. So that's why these both the losses are called as constant loss. And whenever I say it's a transformer, it's a constant flux machine, means provided input voltage V1 is constant. Okay. When V1 is constant, flux in the core remains constant. Okay. Even practically everywhere is constant. Now we'll see what's about the, what do you mean by eddy current loss? Alternating flux flows through core that we have seen in previous lecture. Now we are talking here about the flux and core. Flux and core, not about the conductor and current. So alternating flux comes in contact with that laminated core. Now that core, it is made up of silicon steel, magnetic material. It is not solid, it is laminated. Means between every two adjacent plate, varnish is there. Each and every plate is of 0.3 to 0.5 mm thickness, and between every plate varnish is there. So whenever this alternating flux comes in contact with each and every plate, as per Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, EMF get induced in every plate of core, and every plate its circuit is closed one. That's why as EMF induced, current starts to flow through every plate, and that is called as eddy current. Now whatever the eddy current flowing in one plate will not flow in adjacent plate, because varnish is there between every two plates. Okay, so eddy current flowing through every plate is different. Now whenever eddy current flow through every plate, that plate will offer opposition, and that is called, suppose consider it's a resistance R core of every plate. So due to it, heat gets produced, and that is called as eddy current loss. Whenever there is a opposition to the flow of current, heat gets produced, and that is called as eddy current loss. That is I square R. Like this also you can define it. So this is all about the eddy current loss. Now here see, here this eddy current loss, it is directly proportional to square of current. Means if you minimize this current, loss also will be less. And how to minimize this current? By using laminated core rather than solid. Okay, you are using laminated core rather than solid, means cross section area you have minimized. If cross section area here you minimize, then resistance becomes more. So if resistance becomes more, then current will be less. So if current is less, as I square is there, so total eddy current loss will be less. And that's why rather than using solid core, laminated core is used. Clear about eddy current loss? Everyone got it about eddy current loss?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we'll see soon why flux in the core always remains constant. First of all, we'll derive this and then we'll see. Flux in the core right now. So I can tell you, wait a moment. Why flux in the core remains constant? Let me check whether all the things done or not for that. Yes, it's done. Now we'll see why flux in the core remains constant. See, this is the primary winding. Okay. You apply across it input AC voltage, then AC current flows through that. It produces changing magnetic field, which flows maximum percentage of it flows through core. Okay, then this one changing flux comes in contact with N2 number of turns. As per Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, mutually induced EMF get induced in secondary winding E2 and primary, in primary winding self-induced EMF. This one point all of you know, up to this number of times we have seen, up to this, got it? AC voltage you apply, AC current flows, alternating flux, comes in contact with N1 number of terms, self-induced EMF, E1 in primary winding, this alternating flux comes in contact with N2 number of turns, mutually induced EMF, E2 in secondary winding. This one everyone got? Okay, number of times we have seen it. Now, up to this point, whatever the flux flowing through core, it is only because of I1. It is only because of N1 I1 or only because of I1. Okay. Now the moment EMF get induced and load you connect across secondary of transformer, as circuit is closed, one current starts to flow I2. The moment I2 starts to flow, what will happen? It will also produce its own flux, isn't it? Will current I2 produce its own flux?
Yes, ma'am.
Current I2 also will produce its own flux. Suppose current produced by I1, if I am going to denote it by phi core or phi 1, so flux produced by I2, I will denote it by phi 2. Now, as per Lenz's law, what this phi 2, what will be its direction? It will oppose the cause producing it. Phi 2 is produced because of I2. I2 produced because of E2. E2 is produced because of this flux in the core, isn't it? Means, what do you think? If this one flux in the core is flowing in clockwise direction, so as per Lenz's law, this phi 2 will flow in clockwise or in anti-clockwise direction?
Anti-clockwise
direction. Got it? Means what it is trying to do? See, more the flux in the core, more will be the EMF induced, and more voltage V2 will be applied to load, efficiency will be more. Isn't it? But what is happening? The moment I2 starts to flow, flux produced by it, as per Lenz's law, it will act in opposite direction with flux produced by I1. Okay. Now, what will happen then? The resultant flux in the core will get minimized, isn't it? See, See, this one flux is flowing in clockwise direction. This one is in anti-clockwise direction. Means this one flux minus this flux will be the resultant flux. So resultant flux, if it get minimized, E2 will be less. If E2 is less, then V2 will be less. Means less voltage get applied across load. So efficiency is decreasing. So what is happening in transformer, the moment phi 2 starts to flow in opposite direction through core, what primary of the transformer does? It takes, see, initially up to this point, before I2 starts to flow, up to this point current flowing is I1. The moment I2 starts to flow and it produces flux in opposite direction and this flux starts to flow through the core, the moment it starts to flow through core, what transformer does? It takes additional current from supply, and which is considered, Karo, you can represent it as I2 dash also or I1 dash also, primary winding. Primary winding, in some books you will find it I2 dash. Here I have denoted it as I1 dash because it is flowing through primary, that's why. Okay, so what primary does? It takes additional current I1 dash, and this I1 dash, how much will be its magnitude? So that whatever the flux produced by it, phi1 dash, it also will be in the clockwise direction, and its magnitude will be same as that of phi2. And what will happen then? These two are equal. This one and this one are equal and in opposite direction each other. So these two will cancel each other. So resultant flux in the core remains constant. Okay, got it? Clear? Why flux in the core remains constant?
Yes, ma'am.
Students, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
One important call was there. Now see here. So is this clear to you why flux in the core remains constant? Any difficulty with this?
No.
Okay. See, up to this point, no current is flowing through secondary. The moment current starts to flow secondary, it will produce its own flux phi 2. Okay, so whatever is its magnitude and whatever is its direction, what happens then? The moment it starts to flow through core, primary takes additional current. How much additional current it will take? So that flux produced by this I1 dash is phi1 dash, it will be in clockwise direction, and its magnitude and this one magnitude phi2 will be equal. Both are equal but in opposite direction with each other. So both will cancel. See, this one is in clockwise direction. This one is in anti-clockwise direction. So these two cancel each other. So how much will be the resultant flux in the core? Phi core. This one, which is produced at no load. So from no load up to full load, this is the amount of flux which continuously and of same magnitude flows through core. But when it will remain, whenever I say flux in the core remains constant, provided V1 is constant. And that is the case practically. V1 is constant everywhere. Okay. So if you change V1, then I1 will change, and in proportion to I1, flux in the core changes. Got it? But otherwise, if you are going to keep constant V1 throughout, and that is the practically the case from generation up to distribution, whatever the transformers are there, number of transformers, step up, step down, input voltage to them is always constant. And that's why we say transformer is a constant flux machine. Flux in the core remains constant from no load to full load. MCQ question. Flux in the core of a transformer from no load up to full load remains constant, increases, decreases. So what is the correct option? Yes, what is the correct option? Flux in the core always remains constant. Okay, so transformer is a constant flux. It remains constant. So transformer, it's a constant flux machine. So see here, in the formula of hysteresis loss and eddy current loss, flux density, flux per unit area, flux is constant. Cross-section area of core is constant. So flux density is constant. Frequency, supply frequency 50 hertz. once transformer get manufactured, volume is also constant, isn't it? Here also all the parameters are constant, and that's why eddy current loss and hysteresis loss, both the losses are called as constant, because flux in the core remains constant and as V1 is constant. But if you are changing V1, then it will change. Otherwise, if V1 is constant, iron loss and core loss is constant. MCQ question, iron loss is variable or constant? Yes, core loss, iron loss, variable or constant?
Constant.
Constant. Copper loss, copper loss, variable or constant?
Variable.
As you increase load on transformer, copper loss increases, decreases, remains constant?
Increases.
Correct. As you increase load on transformer, I1, I2 increases, and that's why copper loss increases. How you can minimize copper loss? By using copper for winding design. Winding you make of copper, copper loss will be less. That is only the option, isn't it? How to minimize hysteresis loss? By using silicon steel. Okay. How to minimize eddy current loss? By using laminated core rather than solid core. Got it? Okay. So this is all about the losses in a transformer. Now, number of times we have seen that E1 and E2 get induced, self-induced EMF and mutually induced EMF in N1 and N2 number of turns. We are going to derive the formula for that. Okay. So see here, alternating flux flows through core. As supply voltage is Vm sine of omega t, so flux also you can define phi of t is phi m sine of omega t, where omega is 2 pi f. As per Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, all of you know, now this alternating flux, it comes in contact with N1 number of turns, N2 number of turns. So as per Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, EMF will get induced. And as per Lenz law, it will try to oppose the cause producing it. That's why I can write E is equals to minus N d phi by dt. In general, for primary also, for secondary also. Here I have done N, not N1 or N2. Means common for both. Okay. Then EMF induced per turn. EMF induced, this is for N number of turns, isn't it? This one formula is for N number of turns. I want EMF induced per turn. If we say EMF induced per turn, means value of N will become? Whenever one. We say, one, correct. One, so EMF induced per turn will be this one. Now differentiate the flux with respect to T. Phi is equals to what? Phi M sine of omega T. Take its derivative. What is the derivative of sine omega T? It's a minus omega into cos of omega t. See here, its derivation, isn't it? Now, this is the equation we are getting for EMF induced per turn. Now, if you observe this equation, this one equation, in this equation, this one is what? Is it a peak? Can we say phi m into omega is a peak? It's a cosine waveform. So whatever this omega into phi m, is it a peak?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So it will be peak. And it's a, this is the instantaneous equation, you can say this one. So this is the instantaneous equation of induced EMF per turn. Means whatever this one parameter, this one is the peak value of EMF induced per turn. Isn't it? So it is phi m into omega. Omega is what? 2 pi f. Okay, 2 pi f. So this is the peak value. We want RMS. So we know peak divided by root 2 is RMS. So see, next one. That is the peak value upon root 2 is the RMS value of induced EMF per turn. So peak value is 2 pi f phi m divided by root 2 will be the RMS value. So 2 by root 2 into pi, 2 by root 2 into pi, you will get 4.44 and f phi m will remain as it is. So this is the EMF induced per turn, its RMS value is this one. If EMF induced per turn is this one, 4.44 f phi m is the EMF induced per turn. So how many turns are there on primary side?
N1.
So if this one is EMF induced per turn, its RMS value. So how much EMF will get induced on primary?
Into N1
means 4.44 F5 M N1, and it's get induced in primary. That's why here we have denoted it by E1, and capital E1 means it's a RMS value. Okay. Similarly, on secondary side, N2 number of turns are there. So whatever this into N2 will be the EMF induced in secondary winding, its RMS value. So these are the derivations of E1 and E2. Now, no one will ask you derivation because it's an MCQ pattern. Just keep formula in your mind. Okay. So E1 is what? 4.44 F5 M N1, and E2 is 4.44 F5 M N2. Which one is correct formula of E1 and E2? Again, whether it is directly or inversely proportional to these parameters. So directly proportional to frequency, flux, and number of turns. And numericals on this. Okay, like this will be the questions. Derivation, don't do the derivation. Just for your information, how we can derive it, that I have shown to you. Otherwise, as due to MCQ pattern, don't do the derivation. Okay, just keep formula in your mind. So, again, if you observe this equation, see 4.44 is constant, supply frequency F everywhere constant. 50 hertz in India. Now, once you design the transformer, number of turns on primary and number of turns on secondary also you can't change. That also remains constant. Okay. And what's about phi m? It remains constant or changes with the change in load? What is phi m? It's a maximum value of flux in the core. So what just now we have seen, flux in the core remains
constant.
So what's about phi m also will remain
constant.
Means what's about E1 and E2 also remains
constant.
But the thing, supply voltage is constant, that is V1 everywhere from generation up to distribution, and E1 E2 also constant. But the thing, flux also constant in the core in the transformer. Now, you take the ratio of these two equations, take E2 by E1. What you will get? If you do E2 by E1, what you will get?
N2 by N1.
And this is called as transformation ratio. It is denoted by capital K. Okay. Capital K transformation ratio formula. MCQ question based on this can be there. Numerical, especially. Now here, so here, 1 minute, here K is transformation ratio. See here, this one. These two relations later on we'll see. You just observe in this term. Forget about this one. Rating of transformer is in given in KVA, then later on we'll derive this. A part of observe here. Now, K, just now I told you transformation ratio, which is denoted by capital K, E2 by E1 is equals to N2 by N1. So, here, if N2 is greater than N1, then you will find E2 is greater than E1 or V2 also greater than V1. How this will be, the rest two terms, how it comes, soon we'll see. You consider this E2 by E1 is equals to N2 by N1 is equals to V2 by V1 is equals to I1 by I2. Now, whenever I say it's a N2 greater than N1, then V2 is greater than V1, means value of K is greater than 1. So, as N2 is greater than N1, so V2 is greater than V1, means it is a step up or step down transformer.
Step up.
Okay. Similarly, the case when N2 is less than N1, then obviously V2 will be less than V1. Then K will obviously will be less than 1. Then it is a step down transformer. MCQ question. If K is greater than 1, then it is a step up or step down transformer. So step up transformer. If it is step up transformer, then N2 is greater, V2 is greater or less. So N2 is greater, V2 is greater. Like this MCQ questions. What the thing? Based on this formula, numericals.
Yes, ma'am.
and when both are equal N2 and N1. So first two step up and step down transformer, it is used from generation up to distribution to step up the voltage and to step down the voltage. Okay. The last one type is when K can also be equal to 1. What does it mean when K is equal to 1 means what? N1 equal to N2. So N1 equal to N2 means V2 is equals to V1. So that is called as 1-to-1 transformer or isolation transformer. Now where this one is used in some electronic circuit, there is a requirement to isolate the circuit, two different circuit. One on primary side, one on secondary side. So there you can use this isolation transformer. Okay. Means voltage is same on both the sides, but there is a need to electrically isolate the two circuits. Magnetically, they will be coupled. Okay. So in that applications, isolation transformer, it is used mostly in electronic field. Okay. But otherwise, this cause to step up and to step down the voltage. Okay. Now, next one, we'll see why rating of transformer is given in KVA. And then that relationship we'll see is equal to, you will get V2 by V1 is equals to I1 by I2. Now, all of you know that is the input and output to the transformer is AC or DC, alternating or direct?
Alternating.
Alternating it is. Okay. It works only on AC, it don't work on DC. Okay. So, input is, in your syllabus, single phase transformer is included. So, what is the formula for single phase AC power? VI cos phi. On primary side, you can say V1, I1 cos of phi1. On secondary side, you can say V2, I2 cos of phi2. Okay. So, this is the formula of power, all of you know. And unit is what? Watt. Now, if you see motor, any motor, what's about its rating? 1 HP motor, HP you can convert into watt, kilowatt, isn't it? Or 1 kilowatt motor, 5 kilowatt, 10 kilowatt motor. Like this are the specifications given of motor. Why? Because once you design the motor, its voltage and current range is known. And cos phi is called as here in this formula load power factor. Motor itself is a load, because for motor, all of you know, input is electrical. This have fan on karte ho. Fan once you switch on. In the fan, motor is there. Means you are going to switch on, means you are going to give electrical input to that motor and fan starts rotating. Means what is the output of motor? Mechanical. So every motor input is electrical and output is mechanical. Means motor itself is a load. In electrical engineering, every equipment which requires electricity for its operation is called as load. So motor itself is a load, means motor power factor. Once motor get manufactured, any motor get manufactured, its power factor is also known. So any motor get manufactured, voltage range known, current range also, and its power factor also known. That's why rating of motor is always given in watt, kilowatt or HP. Okay. But what's about the transformer? On transformer, we have seen on secondary, we connect load. Suppose lamps you are going to connect, isn't it? So, I told you, suppose in our college, backside of workshop, that distribution transformer is there. So, what is the load on the secondary of transformer? Our college load, entire load. And it is not fixed. Everywhere, we continuously go on switching the tube light, fans, fridge, mixer, heater, iron, on and off, isn't it? So load continuously changes, and that is the load on transformer secondary. This one is the load, which one you continuously make on and off. It is the load on distribution transformer, it's secondary. If load changes, then obviously cos phi will go on continuously changing. Isn't it? Means cos phi is not fixed. It go on continuously changing and it depends on the load. Isn't it? But once you manufacture the transformer, its voltage range and current range are known. Isn't it? So that's why rating of transformer is not given in watt and it is given in volt amperes. That is KVA. KVA means what? K means into 10 to the power 3. Those who means if your last one experiment sorry, fifth one it is direct loading method on single phase transformer. If you know the specification of that fifth one experiment in BEE practical, this one is the transformer. 1 kVA rating, 110 volt / 220 volt. Okay. So every transformer, it is not open. It is covered with outer metallic body. And on its body, you will find one rectangular nameplate. Okay. Every motor, generator, transformer, nameplate is there. On that nameplate, you will find the specifications. So for this transformer, whatever you are using for BEE practical experiment number 5, these are the specifications of it. It's a 1 kVA transformer. See, its rating is given in kVA and not in kilowatt. Volt amperes. 1K means what? 10 to the power 3. 1 into 10 to the power 3. That is 1000 volt amperes. Got it? Cos phi is unknown. Load power factor continuously go on changing as load on transformer continuously changes. And primary side voltage is 110 volt. Secondary side voltage is 220 volt. Okay, like these things you will find on each and every transformer on its nameplate. So kVA rating you will find, V1 and V2 voltage also you will find. Now what is the benefit of this three? One more reason is there that we'll see first. Why rating of transformer is given in kVA and not in kilowatt? One reason I told you, cos phi changes. It depends on load. Load continuously changes, so cos phi also continuously changes. But voltage rating and current rating of transformer, we know maximum voltage rating and maximum current rating. So using that, you can calculate the kVA rating. That's why rating of transformer is given in kVA and not in kilowatt. Other thing is, just now we have seen the losses. Which one losses takes place? Core loss and iron loss. Core loss depends on voltage or current. Just now I told you flux in the core remains
constant.
Why flux constant in the core remains constant? Because
voltage is constant.
And that's why we say core loss, iron loss, that is hysteresis and eddy current losses are constant. What does it mean? I can say core loss and eddy iron loss, they depend on voltage, isn't it? If voltage changes, flux will change, and if flux changes, these losses will change. But practically voltage is constant. That's why flux in the core is constant. And that's why these losses are constant. What does it mean? Core loss, iron loss depends on voltage. MCQ question. Core loss, iron loss, they depend on voltage or current. So they depend on what? Voltage. Okay. Copper loss. All of you know. Copper loss, as you go on increasing the load on transformer, in previous lecture we have seen I1 increases, I2 increases. That's why I1 square R1, that is primary copper loss, and I2 square R2, that is secondary copper loss, both will increase, isn't it? And reverse case will happen when you decrease the load. When you decrease the load, I1, I2 will decrease and primary and secondary copper loss will decrease. What does it mean? Copper loss depends on which parameter? Current, isn't it? Okay, yes, so core loss, iron loss depends on voltage, copper loss depends on current, and that's why rating of transformer is given in volt amperes. This is the another reason. Got it? No one will ask you theory question, isn't it? Otherwise, in offline exam, that handwritten before pandemic, these questions also included, explain the losses and all. And why rating of transformer is given in kVA. So two reasons are there. The first one is this one I told you. Load power factor, load changes, so cos phi not fixed. And once transformer get manufactured, its voltage and current range are fixed. Maximum voltage and maximum current range are fixed. So that rating is given in kVA, not in kilowatt. Another reason you can tell, core loss, iron loss depends on voltage. And copper loss depends on current. That's why the rating of transformer is given in kVA. Now, what is the benefit of the C? On nameplate, I told you like this are the given. It's a 1 kVA transformer, 110 volt, 220 volt. Why rating of transformer is given in kVA and not in kilowatt? Is this clear to everyone?
Yes,
Yes, ma'am.
हाँ, MCQ question. Rating of transformer is given in KVA kilowatt. So which one is correct option? KVA. Options given to you may be volt ampere only or maybe MVA. KVA means into 10 to the power 3. MVA means into 10 to the power 6. VA means nothing. Huh? Volt amperes as it is. Into nothing, into one only. Isn't it? That all of you know that. So what is its benefit when KVA rating and on the nameplate you find the parameters, this one. Now see, this is the KVA rating. Means what? V means K means into 10 to the power 3. V means voltage and A for ampere. So to this 1 KVA, if I divide by V1, consider ye V1 hai and this is V2. If you divide it by V1, what you will get? KVA divided by V1. You will get ampere. Isn't it? Similarly, yes, KVA ma'am. Divided by V2, you will get I2. Means if you divide by KVA rating by V1, you will get I1. And if you divide KVA rating by V2, you will get I2. Using this, whatever the, see, KVA rating of transformer into 10 to the power 3 is equals to V1 I1 is equals to V2 I2. Okay. So, if you take V2 by V1, you will get I1 by I2. Just now we have seen that thing, K is greater than 1, less than 1, equal to 1 there. What was the case? K is equals to E2 by E1 is equals to N2 by N1 is equals to V2 by V1 is equals to I1 by I2. Okay, this one, based on this formula, numericals will be there. Huh? K is equals to E2 by E1 is equals to N2 by N1 is equals to V2 by V1 is equals to I1 by I2. So, ye dhyan mein rakho. KVA rating into 10 to the power 3 is equal to V1 I1 is equals to V2 I2. Now, ye KVA rating is given on nameplate. V1 is also given on nameplate. V2 is also given on nameplate. So the nameplate values, if you use, then whatever the I1 you will get, that is called as full load current on primary, and whatever the value of I2 you get, that is called as full load current on secondary. See, these are the specifications given on transformer nameplate, single phase 50 hertz transformer, the same I told you. Now see, KVA rating into 10 to the power 3 divided by V1 is what? I1 full load. Suppose 1 KVA transformer is there, divided by 110 volt primary side voltage, you will get 9.09 ampere. Similarly, you can do for I2 full load. I2 full load is what? See here, KVA rating into 10 to the power 3 divided by V2. So 1 into 10 to the power 3 divided by 224.545 ampere. Now, whatever the I1 full load and I2 full load you got from this specifications value, what is its benefit? Means how much load, maximum load you can put on transformer. Suppose across transformer, I am connecting 2 lamps in parallel, 4, 10, 20, 100. So if I find, suppose I have connected 10 lamps in parallel or 20. Suppose I connected 10 lamps in parallel, current flowing through I1 is less than this, current flowing through I2 winding is less than this, then you can put 10 lamps on transformer. Now, rather than 10 directly, I'm going to connect, suppose 20 lamps in parallel across transformer secondary. Now, the moment I switch on, if I observe current flowing through primary is greater than this value and current flowing through secondary will also be greater than this value, immediately you have to switch off the load. What does it mean? Transformer get overloaded. And if you overload the transformer, means what? Overloading of transformer means what? Current through primary is greater than 9.09 ampere and current through secondary is greater than 4.545 ampere. If like this is the case, then what will happen? Primary and secondary windings will burn. Then insulation also will get damaged. You have to replace everything to remove the windings from that core. It's time consuming and costly also. Okay, that is not easy task and it's costly also. So this is the benefit of I1 full load and I2 full load. So on the nameplate, you will find KVA rating, V1 and V2. Using this, you can calculate I1 full load and I2 full load. So what is its benefit or advantage or application? Once you know this value, means this much only you can put load on transformer. not beyond this. Okay, how much load you can put on transformer so that current in primary should not exceed this value and current in secondary should not exceed this value. Okay, so got the things, everyone? I1 full load, I2 full load.
Yes, ma'am.
So ये इसके ऊपर numerical है, question bank में रहेगा. Okay. KVA rating is given to you, V1 and V2 given to you, and they will ask you calculate the I1 full load and I2 full load. What the thing? This is the formula. KVA rating into 10 to the power 3 divided by V1 is I1 full load. KVA rating into 10 to the power 3 divided by V2 is I2 full load. Okay? This is about the I1 full load and I2 full load. Okay? Okay, so next topic we'll see. This is KVA rating, we have finished. This derivation is over. This is the constant law. Now this one, core type and shell type of transformer. Up till now, to understand the working principle and derivation, isn't it? That E1, E2, what happens when the transformer is unloaded, not loaded. What I have shown to you, primary winding separately on primary, right side limb, and secondary winding separately on left hand side, isn't it? But that is not the case. Practically, what is the case? Two types of transformers are there, core type or shell type. So core type and shell type means, if you observe in core type, you will find two side limbs only are there, but in shell type, along with two side limbs, central limb is also there. And what is happening in core type, if you observe on these two side limbs on right and left, both the windings, primary and secondary, both are wound on both the side limbs. It's not so that primary on left side and secondary on right side. It's not so. Okay, so see here, red one I have denoted as HV. HV means what? High voltage. You consider high voltage. You can denote here LV also. This is just one I selected. Red one is HV. And see here, blue one I have marked as LV. See here, yahan pe likha hai maine. Blue one is LV and red one is HV. First lecture also I told you, more the voltage, these primary and secondary winding are made up of copper. They carry the current. So they are insulated with some insulating material. Which type of insulation to select? What is the thickness of that insulating material? It depends on the voltage range. More the voltage, more will be the thickness of insulation. Okay. So compared to LV, HV requires more thicker insulation. So here, you will find near to core in every transformer, near to core is always LV. So on right and left both you can see, pehle LV winding on kiye, blue color ki. Okay. Aur phir ye dekho, yahan se suppose LV turn start hua, phir ye pura yahan pe LV wound kiya, blue color, phir ye same winding ki turn idhar aa rahi hai, aur is pe bhi pehle LV wound hua hai, like this. Theek hai? Ye yahan pe LV, phir iske upar HV ki turn rahegi from top to bottom. Pehle top to bottom, near to core is always LV you will find. HV requires more thicker insulation. So HV is there always you will find above LV turns. So see, yahan pe HV start hua, phir it is above LV turn on this side, then the same continue this side, then again on LV it is, and so on. Yahan pe maine do hi layer dikha hai, depending on number of turns, alternate layers of LV, HV you will find. पहले LV की टर्न, फिर उसके ऊपर HV की, then again LV की, then again HV की, like this. Clear? So this one winding arrangement is called as concentric cylindrical type of winding arrangement. Which one you will find in core type? Now observe the shell type. What is done here? In shell type, turns primary and secondary winding, that is LV and HV, they are not wound on side limbs. Both are wound on central limb only. So central limb पे पहले कौन सा रहेगा always? LV. See, pehle LV ke turns hai from top to bottom, phir uske upar HV ki. No, it's not like this. By mistake, I have drawn like this. Dekho, yaha pe aise rehta hai. Pehle LV ki turn rehti hai. Suppose this one near to core LV. Suppose ye 10 turns hai. Here also near to core always LV turns 10. Phir iske beech mein HV ki rahegi. Iske baad HV. Then again LV. then again HV, then again LV, like this. Central limb, yeah, central limb. So I say, so ये जो white दो blue के बीच में you assume HV turns are there, ठीक है? तो ये sandwich type of construction बोलते हैं इसको. Between two LV, HV is sandwich. So this is called as sandwich type of winding arrangement, and that is there in shell type of transformer. Clear, everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So in shell type, sandwich type of wiring arrangement you will find, and in core type, concentric cylindrical type of wiring arrangement you will find. 1 minute, मैं दिखाती हूँ आपको. वो गलती से मैंने वैसे draw किया है by mistake. ये देखो यहाँ पे पहले नियर टू कोर रहेगा ऑलवेज एलवी. सी दीज आर द एलवी टर्न्स, ठीक है? फिर उसके बाद रहेगी एचवी की टर्न्स, फिर से एलवी की टर्न्स, और फिर से एचवी की टर्न्स, लाइक दिस. यहाँ पे सिर्फ दो ही दिखाई है, हियर ओनली एलवी और हियर ओनली एचवी, बट वो बहुत क्लोजर रहती है और लाइक दिस. Here few LV turns, then HV, then again LV turns, then again HV, then again few LV turns, then again HV, and near to core always LV. So between every two LV layers, means HV you will find. That's why it's a sandwich type of wiring arrangement. Okay. So if you compare comparison between both core type and shell type, so if you observe this one, see flux in the first one. So what is the difference? You can say here only two side limbs are there. Here central one limb is also there along with two side limbs. Okay. Here LV and HV or primary and secondary winding both are wound on two side limbs. Here both are wound on central limb only. Okay. If you observe here concentric cylindrical winding type of arrangement is used. Here sandwich type of wiring arrangement is used. Now here if you observe flux will flow like this. This It is having only single path, so it's a series. It's an example of series magnetic circuit. Here both the windings are wound on central limb only, so resultant flux get produced in central limb. Suppose it is flowing in upward direction. So once it reaches at this point, it has two path. Some flux will flow through left side, and some flux will flow through right side. Means if you find here. Whatever the flux in the central limb is the addition of flux in the two side limbs. So this is the example of parallel magnetic circuit. Okay. And again, what else? ये core type जो है, here maintenance is easy compared to shell type. Core type is used for low voltage applications. Shell type is used for high voltage application. In core type, more natural cooling is possible as winding encircles the core here. But in shell type, core encircles the winding, and that's why less natural cooling is there. So this is about the differences between core type and shell type. What the difference between core type and shell type transformer? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So can I stop here lecture, because next